Earl Skagel, ladies and gentlemen.
How about Willie Bass? Forget about Earl Skagel.
Tales from the Sunset Strip, live at Cantor's Deli. Ladies and gentlemen, want to thank you guys for tuning in. We've got some current news going on. I'm not sure if I like it. You know, people are committing suicide. We got people pissed off and shooting people, man, and I don't know what to think. I don't know what to say. But my heart goes out to the people at the Empire State Building. We had a random shooting at the Empire State Building today. Breaking news. 11 people shot. Couple of people dead. Homie got pissed off. Killed a co-rope worker, and went to the Empire State Building and started shooting. You know, that's not cool. This is not good. It's got nothing to do with gun control. I mean, am I right?
I think a guy like this is going to cause trouble, whether the gun control laws are current or not.
Well, I don't think it's got a lot to do with gun control. It's the people, not the guns. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's like the guy in Colorado. He would have done that regardless of the law or...
Right.
I mean, pretty much any, the guy in Sweden who killed all those people, or Norway.
Right.
They would have found the gun or whatever weapon of choice. So there's some messed up people out there, Willie.
Yeah, we got to, you know.
And not all are in the entertainment.
One of our sponsors is NAMI, which is National Alliance on Mental Illness. And believe it or not, the statistics say that 1 in 4 people, not Americans, but One in four people suffer from some sort of mental illness, and it goes untreated. It goes untalked about, and you know, we need to expose this. We need to do something about it because, you know, random killings is just not the way to go. And then we want to give a shout out to James Jameson Jr. We hear it's his birthday today. On a better note. And wasn't there an anniversary of something today of something or another? Or what was it?
Rats Out of the Cellar album coming out?
Maybe it was Queensryche. No. Okay. Lance Armstrong, for some reason, this guy got banned for life, and he never failed a drug test. So I don't know what that may be a little bit political, you think?
Well, I think it's he has good doctors who know how to dope what he was taking. You don't win the Tour de France 7 years in a row, natural.
You don't?
Well, I don't think so. I mean, it's possible, but
well,
not
Lance
likely.
Lance is Mr. Superman, dude.
Yeah, but there's, you know, Superman, and then there's Ridiculous. And okay. Superman's a fictional character.
All right. Well, we want to thank the house band, Mr. Scott Page, Alvin Taylor, James Kotek in the house.
I mean, this is a band.
Yeah, Jimmy Taylor on guitar and... You know, it's just amazing. J.P. Cervani from the Gypsy Experience coming by to lend a hand. And we're excited to be here. We've got a special guest coming up who's got a book called Jimi Hendrix, A Brother's Story. Mr. Leon Hendrix in the house today.
All right.
Yeah, come on.
But first, we're going to go with the concert report. We've got Ted Nugent is out playing again. Can you believe that?
Lock your underage daughters up.
Yeah, we've got some cool concerts coming up. We got Motley Crue in Colorado. Believe it or not, Fish is in Atlanta, Georgia. Ted Nugent is somewhere in Mississippi. Joe Walsh is on tour. Dude, Joe Walsh. Yeah, it's tonight. He's in Shelton, Massachusetts. And, of course, we got Def Leppard, Poison, Lita Ford. They're in Indiana. Oh, Metallica is doing some dates up in Canada. Jane's Addiction is in Omaha, Nebraska. Should be there for that one.
That'll go
Love
over.
Those guys, man. Joe Walsh tomorrow night in Salem, Oregon. And Lynyrd Skynyrd is doing some dates. And, of course, last but not all, ZZ Top is out there playing. ZZ Top, man, with the original lineup. Wow. ZZ Top is in, what do we got? They're in Washington. Amway Heights, Washington. Don't know where that is. I should be there. ZZ Top kicking ass. My
Leon
boys.
Leon knows.
Leon knows where that is.
Where is that, Leon, in case?
It's in Washington.
It's in Washington. Oh, you heard God. It from the man. No,
I
Washington.
Oh, that's me.
DC4 at Vamped in Vegas.
And D. Snyder coming up at the Key Club.
Oh, D. Snyder.
Playing
the original Twisted Sister singer?
Yeah. I thought he was the only Twisted Sister singer. Was there more than one?
Well,
you know
I see double.
80s metal. We got two Rats touring, two LA Guns. I mean... Some may say two great whites, watch out.
A new Queensryche?
Two Queensryche? I mean, some may say one Queensryche is enough.
Somebody's texting me.
Who's texting Willie? Al Bain for leather? Is it Al?
Al Bain for leather in the house.
Fine leather wear.
Al Bain for leather, forleather.net. Visit Al Bain. He's got straps and working apparatus for the working musician.
Jock straps, guitar straps, whatever you need, Al
Bain. Cod pieces with saw blades. Al did the original I Fuck Like a Beast, attire for Wasp.
Great Blackie Lawless.
Blackie Lawless, yeah.
Did you do his mic stand too, Al? That's quite a mic stand Blackie's got.
He did the logo that caught on fire. Or something like that, or at the troubadour, you know.
Oh yeah, that was,
when they threw the raw meat and
I was there. I got
I was
a piece
on that
of meat.
Show, dude. I was
really
yeah. Black Sheep open up that show. L.A. finally gets rid of Wasp.
You won't see a lot of black guys at Wasp shows. I'll tell you that much.
No, we rehearsed in the same in Fritz's mom's basement. And yes, I was the only black guy within 50 miles.
Oh, definitely that show. I saw one the other night at Cheap Trick. I'm like, Jesus, this guy must be lost.
No, you'd be surprised. J.P. Cervani in the house.
Yes.
J.P. All the way from Italy, man. How the hell are you?
Leon's everywhere, man.
So, Earl, give us a couple of minutes.
Well, you know, it's a lot going on in the world right now. This crazy stuff, you know. Little League World Series is going on right now, so Jerry Sandusky's very upset. He can't watch it anymore. Got Rat touring still, you know. I saw Rat the other night play. You haven't lived till you've heard Stephen Piercy sing live, man. That's I think a couple coyotes showed up when he started singing, and you know.
Coyotes or coyotes?
Both. I mean, it was he's quite a, you know, without Pro Tools and him singing raw, it's quite an effect. And saw Kiss and Motley Crue recently.
Kiss and Motley Crue,
and,
yeah.
Both
with the auto-tune.
Vince Neil's an amazing magician because he would put his mic down and you'd still hear his vocals. So
how do you do that?
I'm not sure. You might want to check behind the stage. I think Tommy Lee had a nice drum roller coaster thing he was doing.
Nice.
You know, and Gene Kiss looked good. You know, Kiss is like the Jewish Menudo now. They got a lot of moving parts in that band.
Wow. We got Neil Diamond tonight at the Greek Theater.
Let's
hear it for Neil.
Yeah, come on, Neil
Diamond. Neil
Diamond, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen. Yes, sir.
Who are these guys?
We got Leon Hendricks in the house, ladies and gentlemen.
Leon
Hendrick wants to come on now, and we're going to have it.
Well, what Leon wants, Leon gets.
Oh, my goodness.
Thanks for coming down.
Well, woo! Did you girls hear that?
Yeah, give Leon what he wants. Just make sure he aims to the left.
And you've got a book.
Hey, it goes to the left.
Well, I'm in the firing line.
Because my girl said, hey, that was you on video. I go, that wasn't me, sweetie. She goes, that was you. I said, wasn't me. He said, your shit go to... I said, there's many go to the left. It wasn't me, baby. Anyway, let's go.
So you have a new book out.
Yeah.
And it came out this year?
Yes.
Cool. A friend of mine was telling me that he read it. I did not read it.
Did he like it?
He loved it. He loved
it. Oh, my
goodness. Herbert Worthington, who was your brother's roommate at one point.
Exactly. You tell Herbie, if you're listening right now, you need to go call Oprah right now. So I can get my shit off the shelves into her, you know, into her concubine.
Well, we're gonna definitely get you out there and do some dates together. I think
all right,
we
cool.
Need to,
I love this band.
Play.
This
yeah?
band.
You feeling it?
Yeah, you guys just playing. I just wanted to jump up and, you know, do the jig with you guys.
Cool, man. Cool.
I love
it. We're honored to have you, and we just want to delve into some information.
Okay.
About you and, you know, growing up.
Okay.
You know, your brother definitely influenced me and in just about everything I do. And
I'm still tripping.
It's funny. I came out here and wound up playing with Buddy Miles and fell right into that camp. So
I love Buddy so much. You know, he was on tour with me, you know, right before he died.
Wow.
And he taught me so much in just the little time that we had together. He taught me.
Well, you know, when I was playing with Buddy, we played up in... what was it? Washington. It was a women's university, Yakima, Washington. Mm-hmm. And we stopped by to see your dad, man.
Exactly.
And I stayed at the hotel like an idiot. Mm-hmm. It's like amazing. But I know that Buddy definitely loved your father, man.
He did. And then, we got my dad loaded one night on weed. And
you and Buddy?
This is like, you know, at the Paramount, you know, way up. When you play at Paramount. The dressing rooms were like 15 stories high. And so my dad was having a good time and stuff. He said, well, Dad, take a hit, right? We had to call 911. Oh, they shut the whole show down because Al Hendricks was having palpitations.
Oh.
He said, Leon, please, where am I? I go, you're at the fucking Paramount Hotel, Dad. He said, I'm hanging out the window right now. I said, because you're trying to get some breath. Don't smoke weed from Seattle. Man. Smoke Mexican, a little mellow, you know. Anyway, it was all good. They came, and he was all right, and he finished the concert.
Cool. Yeah. I always loved Seattle, man. You know,
Seattle's awesome, dude. Seattle's
a lot of good music came from out there.
I know. Well, you know why? Because when it rains, motherfuckers need to go into their house and play music. When the sun shines, motherfuckers want to go out and play volleyball and go golfing and stuff. But when they have to stay inside, they start playing their music. That's why there's so much music coming from Seattle, because the climate is so mellow. Mm. See, we don't have harsh winters, and we don't have hot summers. We're just like in between, and that allows you to be creative.
Cool. So when Jimmy was in the service, were you in touch with him during those times?
Of course, I was in the service too. But
really?
Yeah, I had a hard time.
Now you're an engineer, or you worked for Boeing? Or
I worked for Boeing. I was a draftsman, and
so that creative gene is in you guys.
Yeah, it comes from the mama. You know, cool. Mama Jeter.
Awesome.
You know, Grandma Jeter. You know. And yeah, I worked for Boeing, but I had to draw the same nut and bolt every day. I mean, I'm saying, dude, I'm an artist. I want to draw an airplane. They said, we know how to make airplane here, Mr. Andrew. You need to shut up. So I had to draw the same nut and bolt every day with gloves on. The same nut and bolt. I'm going, wait a minute. You guys got Xerox over here. Can't you just copy that? You know? And they said, we make airplanes here. We don't need your advice right now. We make, you know, like we're successful. So I draw nuts and bolts for a while, and then I quit. Because I just couldn't do it because, you know, I'm an artist, you know.
So what led you into writing the book?
Well, because, you know, a lot of people came to me to write books. And if you notice that all the nice quotes in all those books come from me. And they never paid me a dime.
Hmm.
You know what I'm talking about? So what I did was I said, well, I'm going to wait till everybody's done writing. And I'm going to write the book. You know, the final book of Jimi Hendrix and his character and how he became Jimi Hendrix. See, nobody knows how he became.
So you have an accurate account for.
Exactly.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. It's good to hear it from you and not from somebody else. Or filter.
If you want to read that book, you can go to Barnes & Noble or go on Amazon.com. It's $10 cheaper.
Wow. So it's available everywhere.
Yeah.
That's great. So tell us a little bit about the show coming up next weekend. You're doing a book signing at...
You know something? You should have asked the guy that put it on. I think it's
the 31st.
Mm-hmm. It's a Friday.
Next Friday. And okay. It's at the John Lovitz Comedy Club up the City Walk.
Yeah, the OBB Kings.
Oh, okay.
The OBB Kings. And I'm going to do a book signing, then I'm going to play with this band and another band. And, you know, I'm in L.A., so I might as well play some music because I'm like, you know.
I love your strat in the poster, in the promo poster.
Oh, that one?
It's unbelievable. Yeah, it's
That's really not a strat. That's called my Harley Davidson. It's stainless steel.
Okay.
And it's like all anodized, and I guess like, you know, $35,000 guitar.
Wow.
And
better keep an eye on that one.
Well,
because Earl likes stainless steel.
Well, who could steal it? Because they'd have to say, this is Leon Hendrix's guitar, right?
I'll put
that. So it's kind of secure, you know.
I'll put that on eBay quicker than Carl Lewis. I'm just kidding.
No, you're not, dude. I do got a 64, though, that Jimmy gave me.
Oh, wow.
64.
Where is it? No.
Huh?
Where is it?
In a safe in lockdown. I'm saving it for my kids. I already got offered $1.5 million for it, but since I don't get any money from the Hendrix estate and the Hendrix family is like on their own and we're doing our own thing, I'll just keep it for their, you know, my grandkids' college education and stuff like that, you know.
Well, you know, I've got a movie script and a treatment, so we got to talk about that later too.
I need
you know, you're supposed to do the real.
I need
account.
A retainer. That's I'm telling you up front right now.
I love it.
What's your budget?
There goes this idea.
It's priceless.
I'm serious.
It's priceless.
Come on. Dude, I'm
no,
serious.
No, you're the blood
this
brother.
This Hollywood. This business.
Yep.
Hey, I'm Jewish. Let me be your agent.
Hey, my girlfriend's Jewish. You know I'm in trouble, and she's German.
Oh, wow. You don't know who to hate.
I don't hate.
Jewish?
Yeah.
Me too.
A black Jew? Oh, shit.
Well, there's many. Sammy Davis?
That's one.
Whoopi Goldberg?
Willie Bass?
Sammy was converted, though. Right.
Sammy was converted, though. He's not a real Jew.
No, he got converted because he was with that white girl.
And all those
and
white guys.
And she was
guys.
Jewish. It's all good, though.
Oh, yeah.
You know, everybody, you know, religion. Let's not talk about religion because there's no answer to that right now.
All right, my client will need $10,000 up front, Willie.
Are you my new manager?
Absolutely, for this project I am.
Well, you're fired. Because I asked for 20.
Hey, we'll need $25,000, Willie.
Too late.
Okay, so good. We've got the book. We've got the movie.
Yeah, it's called, let me explain. It's called Jimi Hendrix, A Brother's Story by Leon Hendrix, and it's in Barnes & Noble or on Amazon.com or any little bookstore in the world. Because when I was in, I just left Poland. 3 weeks ago, and they already had the book over there.
Cool,
great.
I'm going, what? I got a book? That's how, you know, that's how you do it now.
Yeah, Pub-
hey, yeah, buddy. What's up?
Is that the
so when did the book actually get released? When did it come out?
I have no idea. I think like a couple of months ago.
How long did it take you to write it? It's like a big undertaking to write a book, isn't it?
Yeah, when a motherfucker's following you around and bugging you constantly, and I'm trying to get a little Jack Daniels or something, and he's like, wait a minute. We got to do this. We got 2 hours. Publishers are calling me, you know, bitching at me. So I'm going, okay, all right. Let's sit down at the nice hotel. Let's get the book done. And so he did it.
So are you familiar with the song Polly Gap?
Of course.
Ha ha.
Oh, my goodness.
It's one of my favorites, man.
Nobody knows nothing about that.
Oh, come on now. Come on.
Oh, my goodness. See, there's a lot of music about Jimi Hendrix that nobody's ever even heard because they only play Foxy Lady, Purple Haze, Hey Joe, All on the Watchtower, but they don't know how deep Jimmy Willie went in his music career, you know? And Polly Gap was like a monster song.
Yes, it was. It is.
It
yes,
is.
It is. Lives today.
And see, when people play it, though, they don't know it. Jimmy wrote that. They said, whoa, that's cool. But, you know, they never give no titles or nothing. But that's Jimmy.
Oh, man. I can hear how he influenced Terry Kath from Chicago.
Well,
I can hear
let me
how
tell you a
he influenced
secret.
Santana. I mean,
I'm going to tell you a little story right now that you don't even know, Bubba. Did you know that Jimmy produced Chicago's first album?
No, I did not.
For free.
Unbelievable.
Because he liked the guy so much. And they said, Jimmy, did we always? He said, no. Just go on. Go on, make your music.
Wow.
That's somebody nobody knows.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah, that first album was monumental.
Mm-hmm. Jimmy produced it. Gave him money.
Wow.
You know? And then Crosby, Stills, and Nash and Young.
Yes.
They were supposed to be Crosby, Stills, Nash, Young, and Hendrix. But.
What?
Exactly. And all. Okay, before I segue, also, what's that other band? That crazy band. Pink Floyd.
Yes.
They tried to hire Jimmy.
Pink Floyd.
They tried to hire Jimmy. But anyway, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, Jimmy said, come to my house in Woodstock, hang out there, and I'll be there. And we'll make a band. But Jimmy never showed up. So Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young said, let's just make this band, you know, at Jimmy's house. And that's how they became Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young.
Wow.
It's
wow.
crazy, dude. Jimmy was everywhere.
Yeah. You must miss him, right?
No.
Unbelievable. Huh?
No, I don't miss him.
You don't miss him?
Because he's always
still here.
He's always here.
That's beautiful.
Know? I go into a bar, try to get a drink without being noticed. And who's on jukebox? Jimmy. I get in my car, turn on the radio. Who's on the radio? Jimmy. You know, so I'm, you know.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it's awesome.
So tell us about your plans coming up, your immediate plans, or what's in the future for Leo.
Well, my next plans are my next phone call, you know. I got a couple of albums out now. You can hear it on Facebook or iTunes. And I'm making a new album right now with Alan White from Yes.
Awesome.
Ricky Phillips from Deep Purple. Are Styx?
No, from Styx, yeah. Styx.
Okay.
And the Babies.
And my background vocals are the guy from Deep Purple, the singer.
Ian Gillan.
Ian Gillan.
Wow.
There you go. So
cool.
That album's coming out pretty soon.
That's incredible. Love the sound of that.
Yeah.
Ricky's a good friend of mine. Good people.
Awesome. Great yeah. guy. Ricky Phillips?
Great guy, yes. Great guy.
You hey, you tell wait, if you see him, you tell him to call me.
So do you have a website that we want to tell
yeah,
people?
Yeah, my
about?
Facebook.
So just go to Leon Hendricks at Facebook / Leon
Yeah,
Hendricks.
That's it right now because cool. Somebody bought my LeonHendricks.com and they're holding it hostage now for like $30,000.
Hmm.
You know. Huh? It's okay, because I'll go Leon Hendricks / you know, just put a / in there, or Hendricks / Leon, and I'll get away from that.
Now you should do yeah. the real LeonHendricks.com.
Real?
The real, like R-E-A-L.
R-E-E-L?
No, R-E-A-L. And then, because you are the real Leon Hendricks.
I already have that. But, you know, I'm just tripping right now. I'm just like surfboarding through life. I'm having fun. I'm going to Europe all the time. Going to Japan.
And you said you went somewhere last weekend. Where was it?
I went to Idaho.
And how was that? Did they receive you well there?
Yeah, because music has no prejudice.
Yeah.
Although there were Confederate flags, you know, Lake Hayden. You know, mm-hmm. I was up there in the midst of the Nazis. You know what I'm talking about? And
they love Hendrix too, though.
Exactly. They say, and they go... And the guy goes, why are you playing Jim Hendricks? That black, you know, he's black, blah, 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 blah. And the guy goes, that's Jimi Hendricks. Yeah, I love Jimi Hendricks. If you don't like it, you need to get out, you know, change your flag or something. You know, that's how it is with Jimmy. You know, he kind of brought people together because music has no religion. It has no color. It's just music. And when you like it, you like it.
Yeah, that's what I really, really respect the most about Jimmy and Buddy was that they transcended racial bounds. They just like brought people together. Because when you look at the footage, you see all types of races, all types of people, you know, males, females, mm-hmm. a melting pot of different people just coming together with love. And they always talked about love, peace and love.
You know, even Jimmy got to the Black Panthers. Because the Black Panthers thought Jimmy had abandoned them.
Mm-hmm.
They see Jimmy. They said, Jimmy, why you dressed, you know, why you don't have the leather hat and the black coats and stuff? He said, because I got Indian, African, and all these colors, and that's me. You see Jimmy on stage? He got everything. You know, Indian
universal,
chief.
Universal.
He from South Africa, everything. He does the whole thing because that's what he was. He was free. Play his music and dress like he wanted to, and you know he had a large following from that, and the Black Panthers to this day I know them in Seattle, they go, we apologize Jimmy,
wow
because you were the real Black Panther, because you didn't hide nothing, you didn't hide behind the leather and the pump fist and stuff like that, you were a real, you know, you real, and they appreciate it now. I know these guys.
Yeah.
You know, Willie, you know, Dixon Brothers up in Seattle, all these guys, they love Jimmy now. They used to hide, you know, when Jimmy first came out, you know, a lot of black people didn't, you know, they liked Jimmy, but they hide the albums in the closet. You know what I'm talking about? Because
the private stash.
They said, hey, you listen to Jimmy Hendrix? Oh, no. We just but now everybody loves it, you know, and he transcended, you know, many folks, you know, and many generations.
And brought,
you know,
people together. That
exactly.
was, you know.
Like when I go to the grave up there and see Jimmy, you know, people that come to see the grave, you got the grandma from the 60s, her kids, and the grandkids coming to Jimmy's grave. So you're talking three generations of people that still love his music.
Yes.
And they're
yes.
being more born every day.
Yes.
To give you an example, on my website, these two guys go, "Whoa, Leon, you're Jimmy Harris' brother. When's Jimmy coming to town? We want tickets. Can you send us tickets?" I'm going, they didn't even know Jimmy had been dead 50 years.
Unbelievable.
You know, that's how music is. Music has no language barriers. Music is a universal.
So was he aware of the peace that he was bringing? I mean, it's almost like it was divinely inspired, the peace and love that they taught. I mean, black people hadn't even been voting 5 years.
I know.
It's just amazing to see that they were bringing people together like that.
Well, like I said, music has no language. Music is the language of the world. And even if we want to attract aliens to us, who we are from, I don't want to open that door. But anyway, come on.
Higher powers.
Music.
Yes.
Music is language.
Exactly.
You know, we're going out there searching, you know, Paul Allen, all these billionaires searching for a radio signal, and it's not a radio signal. It's not. You know, they're searching for the wrong thing. Yeah. You know. Anyway, okay, I'm done.
So
what's up, Bubba? I love you guys' music.
Thank you.
Hey, Willie. Give me your number right now because I need a band here in L.A. I deny a lot of gigs because I don't have a band here.
Well, we're gonna hit the world, man. We're gonna take this show on the road. We're gonna be everywhere. Absolutely.
Okay.
Got to do it. We want to announce
payment.
Again. Leon's gonna be at John Lovett's Comedy Club on Friday, August the 31st. Tickets are available at John Lovett's online. I don't know if that's .com or .net, but you can find it online. I'm sure if you just Google, Leon Hendrix at John Lovett's Comedy Club, it'll come up. And I've done some press releases and stuff about it myself.
And plus, I'm doing a book signing.
Doing a book at 8 o'clock, 8 to 9 book signing.
It's rock and roll.
I'll be there.
We're gonna rock and roll later that night.
I'll be there.
Absolutely.
No matter what.
And we're going to broadcast from there on Friday at 3 p.m. We're going to broadcast from the club mm-hmm. in the daytime. And so we'll be having you back.
So I'm looking forward to playing with you guys.
Cool.
Okay. Because my set doesn't include some of the songs that you guys play. That, you know what I'm talking about? So I want you to bring me up when you guys play.
Great.
You know, and I'll do a couple of songs, and I'll do, you know, the out. With the other man.
Looking forward to it.
Me too, brother.
Now, who was the singer with Traffic?
Steve Winwood.
Stevie Winwood. Now, Jimmy was, there was talk that he and Stevie were going to do a project, or that they jammed together. What was the story on that?
Okay, here's what that is. Straight from the horse's mouth. Jimmy wants to play with everybody.
I heard he played with John McLaughlin too, didn't he?
Yeah, but that was a disaster for John. I'm sorry.
Was it?
I'm sorry, John, but come on, you can't play with Jimmy. Okay. Anyway, no. Dave Mason.
Dave Mason, yes.
Okay. Jimmy wanted to play with him, but there was nothing happening at the time. So Jimmy said, "Hey, come and play on Watchtower."
Is that him on Watchtower?
Yeah, that's his first. That was his first paying gig.
What?
Yeah. You hear that 12 string in the background of Watchtower?
Yes.
That's him.
Stevie Winwood? Dave Mason.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Dave Mason. But Stevie Winwood also played on a Voodoo Child, Slight Return, because, see, Jimmy played an E-flat. And in them days, you didn't have E-flat on the piano because you had to do transpose, all kind of shit. But now you just push a button to go to E-flat. That was Stevie Winwood's first job, too. Playing on Voodoo Child, Slight Return.
Wow.
You hear that organ in the background? That's him. You know, that was his first break.
Wow.
So Jimmy brought a lot of people to the forefront.
Well, I heard he helped Buddy get his deal on Mercury or whatever that was.
Well, you know, that's another story. I remember when I came, Jimmy sent for me, and I came to L.A. to play the Hollywood Bowl.
Jimmy played the Hollywood Bowl?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And then we went.
See, that's more tales from the Sunset Strip. Jimi Hendrix played the Hollywood Bowl, ladies and gentlemen.
Twice.
Wow.
Well, anyway, let me tell you a story. Okay, here I am. Jimmy gives me money, and I come to L.A. I go to the Hilton Hotel. You know, he says, meet me at the Hollywood Bowl. So I meet him up there, and they won't let me in.
Oh,
I said, I'm Jimmy's brother. He go, you ain't got no badge. You ain't getting it. And me and Buddy Miles is right there playing on the fence with his drumstick. They won't let him in either.
They wouldn't let Buddy in either?
Uh-uh.
Oh,
so this
God.
Is Buddy was a kid. He was a kid, a little afro and stuff. He was just playing on the fence. And so Jimmy pulls up in his limousine with his little models in the car and stuff like that. And he goes, that's my brother. And that's Buddy. They get to come in. You know, and that's it's in the book.
Cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
Good night and so long.
We're not done with
I'll see you
my
on
brother.
Friday. Yes, you are.
We're not.
I'm done. I got
We're gonna have you back. We'll have you back next week then.
Okay, good.
Cool. Thank you so much. Leon Hendrix, ladies and gentlemen. So we got Mr. Al Bain in the house. Al Bain for Leather. Come over and give us a couple of words, Al. Al Bain for Leather. Now, Al, me and Al go back. You used to sew me in as I was going on stage at the country club.
Oh, Willie, those are the old days.
When I was a young lad. But what's going on with Al Bain for Leather right now? Any interesting projects?
You know, we're designing a leather floor.
Really?
Yeah. We're going to be making these little floor tiles. We did a floor for Mariah Carey last year.
Oh, wow.
And now my buddy owns a flooring company, Mark Chubin. He's in a little band called Russian Dragon. They're like top 40 band.
Cool.
But he wants to mark these floors again, so we're going to...
So they're leather floors, like for the den? I mean, could you lay on these floors or what? Leather floor?
You'd be surprised. Wow. They go anywhere in the house.
Wow.
You know, but what he wants to do is he wants to do custom logos in the middle of a couple of the centerpiece tiles, you know.
Cool.
So you have a plain motif around the outside and then like the band's logo in the middle of the room or something.
Well, I love your new straps. You know, the way that you constructed these straps with the layers really is comfortable on my shoulder. And
awesome.
You know, I'm 12 pounds of bass on my shoulder. It's very important that it's made out of the right materials that doesn't dig into my arm.
Well, they're all made out of garment textiles, but we laminate them together with special adhesives and stuff so they stay really supple and soft so that they don't dig in anywhere like that.
Cool.
Bought a really cool sewing machine for sewing them together, though. That's the awesome part.
So tell us a little bit about your shop and the location and all that.
Well, the shop right now is on the Location Ranch Studio. It's a film studio, but it's up in the Big Tujunga Canyon.
Some acreage up there, right?
We got about 300 acres up there. And we do outdoor film shoots, you know, like for the Sons of Anarchy and the Discovery Channel, stuff like that. And I'm lucky enough to have a specialty trade that's useful there. So a film crew will
sewing
show up.
Sewing cod pieces?
Haven't done any cod pieces at the ranch, but if they need one, I'll be glad to do it.
Cool. So you've got all your machines up there, and you can sew right on location.
Right
for whatever,
on location, we're
whatever
ready
filming
to go.
Or whatever video shoot or whatever.
Absolutely, we're ready.
There's
to
been
go.
some good shoots up there, right? Great White and who else was up there?
Great White shot a video there 2-3 months ago, and then the Dirty Projectors shot there for a few days.
And then Solnaquois.
Solnaquois did a photo shoot. They did stills there.
Cool.
And then Tracy Underwood and Joe Floyd were there last month.
How exciting.
Yeah, that was pretty fun. I mean, Tracy with her 50 costume changes for a 3-minute video, that was pretty fun.
Wow.
But they did Venus, you know. So, you know, from 1 minute she's an angel and the next minute she's a demon. So it was pretty fun.
Pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Well, it's an honor to have you back up. And to talk with us. It was great seeing you at the Marilyn Manson show for the Sunset Strip Music Festival. And, you know, I love the dress that you made. Tell us a little bit about the dress real quick.
Well, Rock and Roll Industries Magazine, which is a magazine I run some ads in, they had the opportunity to set up a little shop there. So it was Rock and Roll Industries sponsors on parade, if you will. And they asked me to put something in their showroom. And so we come up with this little dress. It's a little tuxedo corset thing. It's pretty cute.
Cool.
Yeah.
And what size was that dress? Could I fit in it?
I think your arm would fit in there. You know, it's a size zero, you know, but we can grade them up and down any size we need. But right cool. now we have a zero.
Well, I really love the stuff that you did for Warrant and the stuff, the Michael Jackson Bad era. That was pretty cool stuff. I mean, I know you hate talking about the past, but it was pretty, you know, monumental, you know, look that that whole thing had.
You know, it was interesting because Warrant was right at the very beginning of their career, and they decided that they wanted to create a uniform look, which was something I'd been professing forever. And we designed this little look for them, and I used to get to Gazzari's, where the shop was, a little bit later. It had my helper, Keith. Remember Keith Mickens, Mr. Keith?
Unbelievable,
anyway,
yes.
He would open the shop with my girlfriend, and I'd show up about 9 o'clock, and I'd go get there, and there's no merchandise. Where's all the stuff? And him and my old lady are sitting there drinking champagne. I'm like, what are you guys doing? Where's the merch? And they go, here. And they whip out a big stack of cash. We sold it all. And the guy wants to meet with you tomorrow. Who wants to meet with me tomorrow? So they send a car up to the house, pick me up, and drive me to Universal Studios. And we pull into the big stage over there. And wouldn't you know, it's Michael Jackson's band rehearsing. So they come out and they ask me to fix this mess that they made, and it's all copies of the Warrant wardrobe.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, so the Warrant guys were a little peeved that Michael kind of upstaged them on their own look, but you know, whatever.
Wow.
I think they got over it.
I think so. They sold a couple of records.
Yeah, right. And they're touring now.
Yes, they are.
Right.
Yeah. My buddy Jerry, he's doing real well.
Yeah. Jerry Dixon. What Jerry a nice Dixon. Guy. A
lot of music came out of that La Cañada area. Van Halen, Dawkins. I mean, it just
Wasp.
Goes on and on. Wasp.
Yeah, yeah.
Wasn't Lita Ford up there? Odin?
Well, Lita lived with Chris up in Haynes Canyon. You know, Haynes so they Canyon. Were together there for a while.
Wow.
Yeah.
Lot of music coming out from there. And I don't think people realize that they were kind of responsible for the L.A. sound. A lot of rock coming out of there.
You know, but that whole era, there was like a creative buzz going on. People really wanted to do it. And I think the difference between then and now is that there was slightly a different attitude toward production and production value. So I think LA is waiting for the next big thing to hit for them. You know, we'll see what happens, but there's all this creative energy
Maybe
right now.
Maybe it's Tales from the Sunset Strip?
Yeah, well, let's hope this is a pivotal point.
Yeah, we hope so.
Yeah.
I think so. But no, we're glad to have you, and we're gonna have to wrap it up because we want to get Mr. James Kotek up from the Scorpions.
Man.
Where's James?
Hey, Roz Richardson's in the house.
Roz Richardson in the house.
Thanks, Willie.
We want to give a shout out to Soko Richardson, who was a major influence, drummer extraordinaire, percussionist. Just want to give a shout out to Soko, who was my neighbor, or he came by the apartment a lot of times, and it's just an awesome human being. And you know, he loved my daughter Amber, and wow. And he played with Alvin with Ike and Tina Turner, and who was the other drummer?
Alan Krieger.
Unbelievable! Wow. So give us a couple of words. Give us a couple of minutes, Alvin. Alvin Taylor, ladies and gentlemen, Alvin Taylor, the man, the legacy. I've been wanting to do this for years, and I always go, Alvin, I'm going to interview you. Alvin, I'm going to bring you up. We're going to talk about, I mean, where do we start?
Wow.
Barry White, Leo Sayer. Yeah, you know, I could go on and on. The Fleetwood Mac camp, you know, Little Richard, Billy Preston. Elton John, George Harrison, my God.
Yeah.
Alvin, dude, you have a legacy like close to Jesus Christ. I mean, really, I mean, that's a lot. I mean, you got more hits than Tony Soprano. Jackson 5, what, ABC? You played on that song?
I did the original, the actual song 45 that was actually that actually came out, that was not me, but the original demo, I played on the original demo.
Cool. With Stop the Love?
Stop the Love, You Save, I Want You Back, yeah.
Unbelievable. Yeah.
But not ABC.
I always, when I hear those Barry White songs and I hear the straight 16ths on the hi-hat with one hand, I know it's you. It's like when I hear that, it's, you know, most people have to do it with two hands, but you do it, your signature with one hand, and it's just awesome. I can always tell when it's you, and it makes me smile.
I learned that stuff from my friend Gatson, who was doing that a long time.
James before. Gatson?
James Gatson.
The
yeah.
James Gatson?
Yeah, that's the Godfather, man. And, you know, I have a lot of influences, him and Soko Richardson. You know, spoke about Soko earlier. Soko taught me a lot, man. I learned so much from that guy. And
see, I didn't know that Soko played traps. I thought I thought he was a percussionist, like congas.
Well, he was. If you look at double bass drummers, okay. Now, of course, when
Soko
we
played double bass.
Yeah, he was the first black drummer that I ever seen playing double bass. I mean,
unbelievable.
I had seen Ginger Baker do it with you know, the Cream, and I'd seen. Yes. You know, Hendrix drummer do it, you know, but man, when I seen a black guy, you know, playing double bass drums, I'm like, who the heck is this? I mean, who the hell is this? And then I realized.
So it changed your life, huh?
Yeah, it totally changed my life. It changed my perspective about what drums were all about.
Amazing.
And this guy played double bass drum, and I mean, he could only, you know, he could play anything, I mean, with it.
Virtuoso on the on the drums.
He could also do the same thing that he could do on double bass with a single bass, and that was just mind blowing. But the fact that he would actually add a double bass, he said, "Oh, I just do that shit to rest."
So cool.
Isn't that him, yeah. Roz? That's him. That's Dad, huh?
Wow.
And I love his daughter, Roz, and I have become really good friends. Who I actually met through you, Willie.
That's amazing.
You know, we've become really
small
good friends.
Small world,
very
getting
close.
Smaller.
Yeah.
Well, tell us a little bit, and I know that there's so much to cover, but, you know, you played on a very monumental album, and I think I saw you with that band when I was like 12 years old looking at In Concert. Tell us just a little bit, give us a minute on Eric Burdon and the Sun Secrets album.
Wow, Eric Burdon, what an awesome guy. I met Eric through a producer who actually owns the band War. His name is Jerry Goldstein.
No, Jerry.
Yeah, Jerry. And Steve Gold actually was the manager of the band at the time. Steve has passed away now. But Jerry had told me about Eric and told me that, you know, Eric was looking for a drummer and sent Eric to Seattle.
Now, is this pre-war, before war?
This was when...
After war.
War was already happening.
Okay.
But had maybe... they had did one song, you know. They had did one song together. And Eric had left and wanted to go on his own. So Eric came to see me playing with a band in Seattle and came back and told Goldstein he liked me and that he wanted me to be in his band and actually asked me to be his band leader and put a band together. So I went and found Alon.
Was the guitar player, right?
He's a guitar player who, if you ever heard the song Rock and Roll Gangster, Alon's the guitar player and the artist for that song.
Yes.
We signed to Arista Records with Clive Davis and got a deal. That was all after the Eric Burdon band, but Eric bought in, well, actually, I bought in Alon, and Eric bought in this bass player named Randy Rice, and we formed what was called the Eric Burdon Band.
Incredible.
And we began to get the band tight, rehearse on the studio, the same studio that War was using. We all had our equipment in the same sound stage, and we rehearsed and went out on an American tour and then took it to Europe, and next thing you know, the band made history. We were on Don Kirshner Rock Concert, In Concert, The Concert, A Concert, every other concert that we could do.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that
great
was...
Great band, great music.
I love Eric Burdon. He's an awesome singer. He's just awesome, awesome guy to be around. I learned so much from Eric. He taught me so much about the industry. And
real innovator, right?
Yeah. Eric told me years ago, he said, there's no greater music. He said the greatest music, he said the greatest marriage is music and films. There is no greater marriage than films and music. He says, I want all of you guys to always have cameras with you everywhere you go, and I want you shooting everything.
And then when was this? Like 70s, 80s?
This is way before. This is like 1970, 1971. This is before MTV ever hit the scene.
So he had a vision.
Yeah, he already knew what was happening. Eric is a visionary. He has a lot of insight. He already knew way ahead of time. He used to tell me, man, Alvin, you need to get a Range Rover. Except a Range Rover. I didn't know what the hell a Range Rover was, you know. But this was like, you know, now I'm looking around, you know, the whole city is full of Range Rovers. Everybody's driving Range Rovers.
Wow.
Hey, Willie, you got a Range Rover?
Incredible. So, you know, what were some of your favorite songs with Eric?
Man, I liked everything that I did with Eric. You know what? We did a Johnny Cash song, this song called Ring of Fire.
Oh, really?
We did a rock and roll version of Ring of Fire of Johnny Cash. And Eric has a book out right now called Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood.
Mm.
And so that's great song, taken from a song, I think it's an old Nina Simone song.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh, Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood. And so I really love playing that song with him. Then we did some songs that was conceived of a movie called Mirage. It was it's a double album, and there were some songs in there. A song called Jim Crow, Stole My Heart, and I can't think of the other songs right now, but that's some stuff that's out on Amazon. You can go to iTunes and find that stuff. It's out. Jerry Goldstein's releasing that stuff like crazy. Hey, Jerry, if you're listening, I need to get paid for this stuff too, by the way.
So now you played with Jimi Hendrix when you guys were with Little Richard.
Yeah,
how
man.
Was that?
Man, that was so awesome. Jimmy used to come on stage as a
They called him Jimmy James, right?
I never knew Jimi Hendrix. I knew Jimmy James. That's all I knew, you know. I knew him as Jimmy James. And then when the album, somebody said, hey, man, check out this badass album. And they showed me the album and said, Jimi Hendrix. I said, that ain't no Jimi Hendrix. That's Jimmy James. And
what a dynamic band with Jimmy Billy Preston and Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
We used to open up the show for Elvis Presley every night.
What?
And so it was interesting. It was really fun to see Elvis Presley hanging out behind the curtains, looking at us and checking out the band. He really loved the band.
Really?
Yeah, it was fun.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Wow. So you know, that's just the tip of the iceberg, but we want to thank you for coming on, and we got to wrap it up, unfortunately. But Alvin will be playing with us at Universal City Walk next Friday. That's Friday, August the 31st, and we'll be having Leon Hendricks sit in with us. We're going to broadcast the show from there on Friday, 3 o'clock. We want to see everybody there. And thank you for coming down.
My pleasure, Willie.
All right.
Kotak.
Mr. James Kotak in the house.
Yes. Yay. Scorpions, baby.
Thank you so much.
Man.
How are you, James?
I'm doing great. I just wanted to say, man, dude, Alvin just kicks ass on drums, man. The whole band sounded great. You sounded good. Willie was playing bass. Open it up for yourself. Jesus.
It's hard work. Thanks,
Alvin's got that thing. But you know what? I want to say it was an honor. I knew Soko very well.
Oh, you did?
Knew Soko, yeah, of course.
Wow.
I met Soko through Krieger, and Soko was just, Soko taught me the fatback. Nobody knows what the fatback is.
Roz, did you
hear Alvin that? Knows what the fatback is.
Soko taught him the fatback.
Yeah, man, Soko. I know. Soko was like, he was just a wealth of information. So RIP, dude. I know he's watching, listening.
Yes. So, James Kotak, Mr. Kingdom Come, what was it? Wild Horses?
Wild Horses.
Wild Horses.
Ronnie Montrose.
Unbelievable, man.
Yeah, I know. I'm so
Scorpions
fortunate.
For 17 years.
I know. I'm old, man.
Just seems like it was a couple of years ago.
I remember one of my very first Southern California performances with Scorpions. You came.
Right,
you were there. We were down in like
because Motley Crue opened up and they had stole my drummer Randy Castillo.
Randy
for
that's
the
right.
Second
Randy
time around.
Oh my God.
First time Lita stole Randy, and then, you know, I think Nikki Six offered him $1 million, and I was like, I couldn't go, well, dude, that's not enough money. You know?
It's all
don't
about
take that gig.
It's all about the rite of passage.
That doesn't sound like Nikki.
No.
No, but it's just an honor to have you here.
Well, thank you. You know, it was great to come down and see a great band. You got a great vibe. I don't know what the deal is with Earl. I think I don't know who you are.
I'm like a middle reliever.
I owe him money.
But Willie Bass, we go back so like 50,000. I think I met you in 1947, you know, and you're just always doing something rock and roll and something cool and keeping it alive, man. There's so many tales from the Sunset Strip that you could tell. It's just awesome.
It's funny. Did you see the picture of Mitch Perry on the golf cart saying he was going to do a Mick Brown impersonation?
No, I didn't see that.
It's on Facebook. It's hilarious, man. But I think the first time we played together was you, myself, and Mitch Perry out at the pier.
Oh, my God, down in Huntington Beach.
Yeah.
I came down to my Cadillac. I used to have a 65
Cadillac.
And it was just enough room. I had a Ludwig Vistalite set that just lived in the trunk. So no matter what, go, hey, dude, you want to play? Sure, I'll be right there. Pull up my Cadillac, empty that bastard. And I had to sell that car, man, because it just needed too much maintenance. Uh-oh.
Well, we got a secret caller.
Somebody's calling.
So much fun. So much fun.
Awesome.
But tell us a little bit more about you've got a solo album, a solo band, Kotek Attack?
Right. I had originally had a band called Crunk, and then
Love
that
Crunk.
But that term became synonymous with a lot of the rap groups. So the record label says, you know what, change it to Kotek. I'm like going, that's my last name. I don't want to do that. But on the advice of Alvin and Mick Fleetwood, always put your name in the title so you can't get fired. Thank you, Alvin.
What a concept.
Yeah. And, you know, I've got 4 albums out now. And
really?
Yeah. And we toured Europe last spring. We
Who's
did
in the band? Who's in the band?
Well, of course, moi. I sing and play guitar, though, in the band.
Cool.
And I suck on guitar, but, man, I look great. And
yeah,
it's true.
You're writing some pretty cool songs, too.
It's kind of like Cheap Trick meets Green Day on a bad day, and it's fun. It's like my passion project. I work with Tommy Hendrickson, who's the guitarist for Alice Cooper, and he's produced so many albums. And he produced it and co-wrote it with me, and I'm very proud of it. So the 4 albums are out. Just go to Amazon, iTunes, et cetera, and all that. And it's fun. It's raw. If you're having a bad day, your dog died, put on a Kotek album, and you'll be smiling in 10 minutes
or
5.
I love it.
Yeah, and it's great. And, you know, it was also a challenge for me to sing and play guitar and be out front because I've been a drummer forever, so I need a new
challenge.
You're
a great front man.
Well, thank you.
Now, tell us about some of the film footage on the Scorpions drum solo, because there was this one where you looked like you were flying and you turned into an airplane, and then, boom, you woke up and you were walking through the desert.
Well, you know, one thing, for those who don't know.
Classic James Kotek, though. You know, well, like, boom, he's in the desert.
I have a drum solo, and the title of the solo is called Kotek Attack. Anyway, I've been doing it for years, and I go, you know what? Who wants to hear another drum solo? Let's add the visual. So we got these monster media screens at our show. So I put together this fantasy film, which there's all the Scorpion album covers. And if you recall, the album covers are like really artistic.
Yeah,
like
Love
in the back,
First
Love
Steam,
Drive, Love It for Steam,
blah, blah, blah.
So those are just stills. So I said, I went to this dude out in Phoenix, and this guy, Paul, and I said, look, I want to make the album covers come to life. So I flew out there and we filmed for a day for like 50 hours straight. And we made the album covers come live, and I present them. And it's like a celebration of the Scorpions albums with a drum solo.
Cool.
And is it visually, and it's wonderful. So just go on YouTube and Kotek Attack.
How did you come up with the thing where you turn into the airplane?
I just kind of said I want to do something really fantasy, like cartoon, like Wile E. Coyote, that kind of a thing. And it worked, man. And they came up with a script, and they had me making out with all these chicks. I'm like, I'm in. So, you know, go check it out on YouTube, and then come see Scorpions live. And,
yeah, it was incredible.
Well, thank you.
So what's up now? I hear you guys are going down south a little bit there in September.
Is that what they call these days?
In the fall? Down south?
We're going to South America September, and then we have like a month in France in November.
Wow.
And a bunch of dates, like 4 shows in Ukraine,
incredible.
1 in Poland. And
I hear you guys are like the Beatles in Russia.
It's really true. But the most
wonderful
thing.
You need a bodyguard to go to the bathroom. What's up
with that, dude? Well, you need somebody to hold it. But the thing is, you know, when the Scorpions said, oh, it's farewell tour, that doesn't mean the band's breaking up. That just means we're not going to tour at this level. We have one more year of touring like this, and it's just a celebration, and we're having a party everywhere in the world.
It's not a grand farewell. It's just sort of like...
It's a farewell.
It's a farewell, really.
Because the Scorpions want to go out on top, which is great. And I just want to say I'm so thankful and fortunate and lucky to be playing rock and roll for 35 years, and that the fact that I'm still 26 years old is amazing.
You look great.
Yeah, I love it.
Thank you.
Now, you've got a book coming out or a movie or what's
well,
going on?
Well, I met a film director named Stephanie Smith, and she
loves Stephanie Smith.
She's awesome. And
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
The best part is she's always walking around topless. That's
okay.
Anyway, she worked on this movie, independent movie called The Wanteds. And The Wanteds is about a one-man band who goes across the country, and he's rediscovering his past, and it starts off Spinal Tap and ends up Shakespeare. And I watched this movie, The Wanteds, and just fell in love with it.
Cool.
And I ended up, like, it's not your typical rock and roll movie. And I ended up, you know, I'm crying my eyes out on the plane going, "Whoa!" Anyway, I've been approached so many times to say, hey, you want to do a drum video? You want to do this video? You want to do that? And I'm like, oh, no, I don't think we need another drum instructional video. What I would like to do is put out...